Hello everybody, thank you for the short introduction. As it's seen on my slide, I'm indeed Paul Kostenberger from the Diagnostic Image Analysis Group in Nijmegen. And I'm going to tell you today about an example use of how we use Docker containers in our department to facilitate deep learning experiments specifically. So just a little bit of a background first. Since nobody typically knows where Nijmegen is, it's a small city in the east of the Netherlands. The university campus is right there. It's interesting now for the context. I'm working in a hospital, which is right there, and this is part of the radiology department. I'm just going to get a thing right there. It's a little bit out of pointless, but it gives away that this is a radiology department, and our department works on medical image analysis. So what does this actually mean? Well, we analyze images like these. Top right, for example, a pathology image. Top left is a lung CT image. And the question that will be asked in our department is, well, are there any interesting pathologies in these images? So for example, cancer, this is very popular. Or also other things, using in retinal images, also very common thing that's being done in our department. So, but how are you doing this? Classically, for 2 years, a decade, our department did this with classical and artificial intelligence technologies, trying to create informed or handcrafted features that describe these pathologies very well, then do some scoring on top of that. That would be a scoring technology for cancer, for example. But then 3 years ago, sort of another technology, namely deep learning, got very popular and actually it outperforms most of the classical methods nowadays. And it's more or less not a supervised machine learning technology, but based again on neural networks. And I won't go into details much, but it consists of equations like these. Only important part here is the W, which are weight matrices, and there are typically a lot of them because the added advantage of deep learning is that one thought it would be very advantageous to have a lot of neural network layer stacks. So you have a lot of these weight matrices and iterate a lot on them, which means that you need quite a lot of computation power to actually train these models and do something useful with those. So you need some sort of specialized equipment which can do floating point calculation very efficiently. And CPUs are just not very capable of this. And well, so luckily researchers got really lucky and got some help from computer games, who around the same time thought, well, we want very good graphics for everything, and that led to the development of the general purpose GPU. Which is essentially a very effective computer in itself for floating point calculations, like the one that you would need for deep learning. Perfect. So, what our department did was buy a bunch of these cards. These are all NVIDIA cards. That's a nice little thing to keep in mind. The deep learning community boxed itself a little bit into NVIDIA hardware. We put them into nice looking boxes like these. And putting them into professional paid networks. This got better by now, but this was this case still, 2 months ago, so kind of funny to put 10,000 euros out of my next year, kitchen sink. Putting the hardware together is just a little aspect of it. It's also about how you set it up so that everybody uses it, which is more or less along the lines that everybody who works in, supercomputer environments or whatever has to deal with, probably. So what we, in a sense, have is a loose collection of machines, and we want to share those among different people. One problem for this was that most deep learning libraries, especially 2 years ago, were in a constant state of flux. So you would get changes every single month, the deep libraries would change, and we couldn't just update them. We did this in the first few instances, just install something and see if it works. But people updated libraries, experiments broke. It was just a mess. So In essence, what you want is to isolate the different research environments. That was one requirement for the new system that we wanted to set up. The hardware, so that means the machines, we want to share them and allocate them to different researchers at different times. So what a single researcher wants to do is properly move their experiment to a machine and from that machine to somewhere else where you can work in isolation on it. So movability of being able to move an experiment is important. And then there's another important aspect, the usual go-to if you are thinking about system administration would be to just use virtual machines for this. A bit bulky, but it would work. But we use the cheaper, not server great NVIDIA hardware, which actually is stripped off the hardware virtualization part. So we couldn't use hardware virtualization to solve this. So, well, that's my actually Docker thing. Well, Docker ticks off two of these marks by, well, virtue of containerization, we get the isolation of the different research environments. And moving experiments also becomes very easy because you can more or less just copy the containers as a whole from one machine to another using the Docker ecosystem, which is very handy. However, sharing the hardware or making it available to the Docker container purely with Docker was still a bit awkward. We had some ways to do it mentioned down there, but they would grant you wild access to all hardware. You could still screw up other people's experiments. So nicely, there's a plugin for that, which is actually a sort of wrapper around NVIDIA in practice, called NVIDIA Docker, which allows you to assign access to single graphics cards to certain containers, which is actually more or less exactly what we want. after we came up with this, we asked ourselves furthermore if it's also possible to use the system for archiving experiments. So this is more or less hitting the sustainability, right? Because if you have an experiment, you maybe want to recreate that experiment years later when the PhD student who created it has long gone. Well, and could we do this with this? That's a little bit of a sore point. I will come back to this a bit later. Let's just keep that in mind. This is really quick. This is the network architecture that we currently use. We have a big data store, deep learning machines that access the big data store. Each deep learning machine that we have can access the internet and therefore Docker Hub. I don't know, I presume many people know Docker Hub already, but you can find nice pre-configured images, actually also for doing deep learning from there. And then we have a manager node, which actually supplies this cluster with useful extra functionality, for example, monitoring a local Docker registry where you can put your own research images, and CERN for job control, workload management. Well, we don't connect to the machines like this. That's about the slide. How would you set up an experiment? Just to give you a little taste on how our system works in practice. First, you would probably look at Docker Hub if you find a nice image that facilitates your experiments. Jam is a very commonly used library, so this fits perfectly. You get all the CUDA environments, etc. And then you write a Docker file, as usual. Install some extra software that you might want to use. Define your entry points. And then you build, as usual, with the usual Docker commands. You then have the option to push this, and it's advised to do this in our system, to the local registry that we have. So then, as soon as you push your image here, it's available to all the machines. So you are free to select one of those. And then we wrote a little wrapper where you can then start the image automatically. This does all the magic for NVIDIA Docker and assigns GPU spot to you if you use these interactive commands. Very convenient. There's a new way to do this as well. We are currently implementing this because it was just a requirement. We have enough machines. We need some sort of automation for job management. We select CERN and just more or less wrap the scripts as you saw before and in CERN scripts, which automatically distribute these among cluster in the local Docker in essence. It works really well. I think we will probably move the whole cluster to the system. And in this context, though, I found that other people thought that there would be an awesome combination as well. There's also this project which tries to do something similar. It's only similar, it's not the same thing, but it's kind of interesting to point out here. So, a little bit of a conclusion of this whole thing. We run this cluster now for, in this configuration for, well, almost 1.5 years. And it's quite stable, which it doesn't sound very good if you see if one in 20 machines needs to be rebooted every week, but that was way worse a long time ago when we had the custom configurations of all machines. And I come back to why we need to reboot one. That's actually a shortcoming of, well, sort of Docker, sort of Redis. And furthermore, the Docker registry perfectly fits our use case where we move experiments from one machine rather quickly. Docker just facilitates it very well. However, there are a few concerns. One of them is the stability of Docker itself. Well, in the past, we experienced this one time. There were changes just how Docker works internally. Changes to file system drivers, changes to APIs. So automation scripts just sometimes break after you updated the daemon. It makes you wonder a little bit how stable the whole system is over a long course of time. So one bit worse point, especially if you mention the point that I made before, can we use the system to archive experiments for a long time? Not really sure if that's possible. Then, just the nature of Docker calls for some, in this specific setup where you give access to GPUs, hardware, some special issues. Since everything shares the same driver setup, and the whole CUDA environment seems to be sort of iffy sometimes, it can happen that someone wrote an experiment which should work, somehow crashes the driver, and then everybody's dead. This is actually worse than it sounds, because since Docker uses this layered file system architecture, and you get a proper kernel panic in that case, it can happen that it just corrupts the whole Docker file system, and then all of those PSF people have lost their data. That happened exactly once until now. I hope it won't happen that often. Like I said, it's quite stable. It's not perfect yet. Really something to keep in mind. Last but not least, NVIDIA Docker, this repo, has a little bit of bad support for high-level management tools like Kubernetes and other things, which are also could also come to the ecosystem of Docker. It's coming. There is no experimental support, I think, for Kubernetes specifically, but it's just not there where you could get with a pure Docker environment. Last but not least, would I advise someone to set up a cluster that's configured like this? It depends. A medium-sized cluster, like we have 20 nodes, about, I think, 50 GPUs, I think that's a really nice thing because you can really leverage the ecosystem. One in the 20 machines crashing for big clusters might be a bit unacceptable though. Could quickly get a grow out of hand. Still, Docker really lends itself well to this, since you can borrow the work of others, the registries, all the containers. And the most important part of it is that you can actually leverage the power of consumer-grade hardware, which is about with professional hardware with virtualization is about 4 times the price of the consumer grade hardware, and have 4 times the graphics card in this case. Well, that's really nice. And that's about it. So thank you for listening, and I hope you found it interesting. And if there are questions.